one run, Lauren. You got that right, and Harold Baines has driven in two of the three White Sox runs here tonight, and he's got a chance to make it three of the four as the bases are loaded with one out. And the Mariners are going to pull their infield in. The outfield is playing shallow. Here's the pitch to Baines. Swing and a fly ball. This will be it. Center fielder's got it. Cruz is tagged. Here's the throw. Not in time. Stop win. The White Sox have won the 1983 American League Western Division title on a sacrifice fly by Harold Baines in the ninth inning.
Winning ugly, that's the story of the 1983 Chicago White Sox. Brought to you by Budweiser, the king of beers and proud sponsor of the U.S. Olympic team. For all you do, this Bud's for you.
For everyone who keeps things rolling on the mighty Mississippi, this Bud's for you.
This is the John C. Byrd breakaway barge. Please respond.
Let's get him.
Just for you, that distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser. For all you do, this Bud's
for you. From the very start, things seemed a little different at the White Sox camp in Sarasota. There was a confidence that the team would rise up and face the challenges of the year ahead with hard work and determination. The Sox 20-7 top preseason record seemed to indicate that the confidence was not misplaced. But manager Tony La Russa knew that despite the many bright spots, there was still some difficulties to overcome.
Last year we were an up and down club, and we hit pretty good, we pitched good, but we didn't catch the ball well, 13th in the league. And I think if you want to become an inconsistent club, that's the way to do it. Just don't play good defense day in and day out. So we are trying to substantially improve it. If you're banking your hopes on a pitching staff, you've got to complement it with a good defense, and our defense is getting a lot of attention in spring training. I think it's safe to say we're going to be better than 13th. The question is, we got to be a good deal better if we want to have a consistent winning club.
Even knowing that consistency was the key to success, there was still no way the Sox could look into their crystal ball and see how things would turn out. Perhaps that was because a clear view of the future was clouded by a less than promising start of the regular season. Things were going so poorly that even when they went well, they went bad. On May 18th, Richard Dotson pitched a masterful one-hitter against the Orioles in Baltimore and lost it.
It was very unfortunate at the time. You know, we weren't playing that well, and Danny Ford hit an opposite field home run against me in Baltimore in the eighth to beat me. So, but that's the way things go. You know, most time it evens out.
But the White Sox and manager Tony La Russa were growing impatient with waiting for things to eventually even out. For them and for Sox fans, the ugliness of losing bad had gone far enough. It was time for the hard work and determination that seemed left behind in spring training. The 1983 campaign was only 2 months old, and the long road to October was far from over. On June 3rd, veteran left-hander Jerry Koosman picked up his fourth win of the season without a loss in a 2-0 blanking of the Kansas City Royals.
And
on June 7th, the Sox headed on out to California. Showing signs of their explosive offensive power, they outgunned the Angels 12-11 in 10 innings, spearheaded by the bull Greg Luzinski's eighth homer of the year. 4 losses later, 2 White Sox rookies helped stop the West Coast skid in Oakland. This home run by Greg Walker got him into the starting lineup. And paired with this triple off the bat of Ron Kittle, the Sox came away with their first doubleheader sweep. The nightcap win went to who else? Jerry Koosman, who went all the way in picking up an 8-1 win, his fifth of the year and 14th in his last 17 decisions. The 40-year-old Koosman's winning ways seemed to be just the thing the Sox needed to stay on the road to recovery. But pitching and hitting weren't the only things going the Sox way. The June 15th trade for second baseman Julio Cruz was meant to bolster the Chicago defense, and that's exactly what it did. On June 19th, Britt Burns stopped a personal 2-game losing streak with this win against the Oakland A's.
The pitch to Billy Allman. Swung on, fly ball, left center field. Baines coming over and in. Kittle is there. He's got it, and the White Sox win it. A 3-hit shutout for Britt Burns. The fourth shutout in his big league career. His first complete game victory of the season.
While Britt was busy burning the A's, the Sox were caught up in a June streak during which they won 12 of 15 games. A big reason for that stability was a bullpen. Salome Barojas picked up his fifth save of the year in relief of Jerry Koosman.
Swung on, popped up, that ought to do it. Julio Cruz backing out in the shallow right, waiting for it, he's got it into the White Sox sweep. And hallelujah, Gus, for the first time since the 8th of May, the White Sox are a 500 ball club at 33-33. Since they bottomed out at 8-under, they have won 17 of their last 26 ball games.
Well, it seemed finally that the White Sox were well on their way to the top, and the ugly start the team struggled through during April and May was behind them for good. Everything was starting to gel. But far and away, the most impressive part of the Sox game plan was the power.
Swing to dead, goes! Way, way back! That ball is up for deck! Home run, Ron Kittle! He jumped on the first pitch and he crushed it out of here!
But when one speaks of power on the Chicago White Sox, you got to start the conversation with this guy, the bull Greg Luzinski.
Left-hander to the belt. Elkers looks at first. There goes Pechorek. The pitch is swung on and hit high and deep to left field. Way, way up. It is on the roof. He did it. Luzinski hit the top of the roof. A two-run homer to tie the score. His 10th in the air. The first White Sox player to do it since Disc in 1977.
The increasingly large crowds which were flocking to that grand old ballpark on the south side were beginning to sense that this year might become something very special. After so many years of losing, the Chicago faithful were thrilled to see the Sox winning brand of baseball. But although the hitting, defense, pitching, and bullpen were all working together in a remarkable turnaround, Lauren Babe and the rest of the coaching staff were also a key in this, the miracle on 35th Street.
It's one of the best coaching staffs in the American League, or if not of all of baseball. We got probably the best pitching coach in Dave Duncan, definitely the best hitting coach in Charlie Lau, definitely the best third base coach in Jim Leland. I think he's only made 2 or 3 mistakes all year. He made 2 last year that we know of. David Nelson, who coaches first base, is also our base running coach, and you can tell how we're doing on just our base stealing ratio now. Then you got Ed Brinkman, who was a Gold Glove shortstop with Detroit. He's helping out our infielders, and everybody's been there. They know what they're doing, so it's the best staff I've ever been associated with, and it's the best staff in the league as far as I'm concerned.
Charlie Lau has helped me immensely, and he's just been a super influence on this ball club in helping young players develop their hitting talents. And Art Kushner does a great job out in the bullpen, as does Dave Duncan with the pitching.
And when you have a coaching staff that's so cooperative and so player-oriented, they're really thinking in terms of the players, and it's so much fun just to come to the ballpark and joke around, have a good time, and then when the game starts, we're relaxed and we're loose, and we get down to business and we play good ball.
Bishurik, the Sox top hitter in 83, knows that playing good ball is much more than running, throwing, and hitting. It's also being alert to any situation, and third base coach Jimmy Leland puts his reputation on the line every day, making sure that potential Sox runs aren't erased by any mental mistakes.
Nobody out now. They'll probably play up. Got to make the ball go through, take a real short lead so that you don't get double on a line drive or take a chance.
The other highly visible coach is Dave Nelson across the diamond at first. His responsibility is making sure Leland gets plenty of action at third.
The only thing I've been able to pick up, the guy kind of hesitates a little bit, all right?
Nelson's insight into Rudy Law's running ability allowed Law to shatter the old White Sox stolen mark with 77 steals.
Delgado well aware of the speed of Rudy Law. There goes Law. The pitch is strike, throw, throw. They don't get him.
No coach, however, concentrates on any one area. It's a total approach that counts.
You know, Tony always mentions something in spring training that I think is sets the whole tone. He always told our players that if one of them got traded or went to another organization, he would feel bad if they got there and said, well, they didn't teach me this over in Chicago, and we try not to leave anything out.
This bud's for everyone who takes the power and sends it down the line.
This bud's for you.
Distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser.
For all you do, this Bud's for you.
July 6th was the 50th anniversary of baseball's Midsummer Classic, the All-Star Game. But the day before Comiskey Park hosted the contest between today's best players, it was the site of a reunion of 88 of baseball's greatest living stars. Included were 41 Hall of Famers, and 13 players from baseball's first All-Star game played 33 years ago right here on this very same field. For Chicago fans, it was a once-in-a-lifetime chance to see baseball history come alive. A chance for youngsters to see players they had only heard about, and a chance for their fathers to recall the golden moments that baseball had given them. One very special moment for White Sox fans was seeing 300 game winner Early Winn back in uniform for his first confrontation with Willie Mays. But the hero of this moment was Brooks Robinson, who showed that being in the Hall of Fame does not necessarily mean that skills are faded. The hero of the day, however, was a crosstown rival, sweet swinging Billy Williams of the Cubs, who hit a titanic blast to ensure yet another National League win. The Chicago faithful may not have minded the senior circuit win in the greatest old-timers game ever played, but the next day was an entirely different story. With the National League winners of the last 11 All-Star games, Comiskey Park fans were hoping their hero would help break the string.
Representing the Chicago White Sox, outfielder Ron Kittle.
As it turned out, Kittle and his teammates had their own idea on the outcome of the golden anniversary game. The American League romped to a 13-3 win, highlighted by the first ever All-Star Grand Slam home run from the bat of Angel Fred Lynn. Once again, Comiskey Park was witness to a historic All-Star moment. With the All-Star game over, Sox fans were eager to start the second half, and their team wasted no time showing them that the midseason break would not slow things down one bit. Carlton Fisk, whose 26 home runs in 1983 set a record for most ever by a Sox catcher, blasted numbers 12 and 13 to lead his teammates to an 8-0 win over the Indians on July 12th. The win pulled the Sox to within a game and a half of first place. But there was something else significant about this game. Left-hander Floyd Bannister pitched a brilliant five-hitter that proved to be the start of an incredible turnaround. And of course, there was that splendid defense which seemed to improve with each and every passing game.
Change and they gotta hurry.
As the month of July passed, first place inched closer and closer. Finally, on July 22nd in Milwaukee, Dennis Lamp nailed down a 2-1 victory over the Brewers, and the Sox had sole possession of first place. The Sox, sparked by the bat of Carlton Fisk, ended the 11-game road trip by taking 3 out of 4 from the then first place Blue Jays up in Toronto. After being moved up to second in the batting order in mid-June, Fisk batted a remarkable .329. Now that the White Sox were on top of their division, the attention of the baseball world was focused on Chicago, where the fans were watching the Sox faithfully, hopefully, and breathlessly.
Every breath you take.
This bud's to everyone who tackles the changes and challenges of that new promotion.
This bud's for you. There's no one else who does it quite the way you do. So this to you. For all you do.
Yep, just for you. That distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser.
For all you do.
Thanks to Texas Rangers manager Doug Rader, the Sox fans picked up a new rallying cry in late summer, and, well, they just loved it. After all, winning ugly is a whole lot better than losing pretty. On July 30th, the largest crowd of the year turned out to see Richard Dotson improve his record to 11-6 by beating the New York Yankees. Final score, Sox 6, Yanks 1, and the Ugly Bunch were 6 games over .500, 4 ahead of second place Doug Rader. Meanwhile, the Bull reminded the Yanks that if the pitching didn't get them, the hitting would.
They're just swinging a deep drive left field, way, way, way back. That's left and right. That's second time the ball has hit one on the roof this year, and the Sox have a 2-0 lead. That's the first home run hit off Fontenot in the big league.
The Bulls' long-distance call to New York enabled the Sox to take 3 out of 4 from the Yanks and gave the American League West the message that the White Sox just might run away with everything. By August the 11th, the Sox increased their lead to 6 games as Floyd Bannister struck out 11 Orioles. That's a personal best. And for the first time all year, Banny now had more wins than losses at 10-9. But 3 days later, the Sox encountered a temporary setback. MVP candidate Carlton Fisk had a game-winning home run taken away by the umpires, who said a fan caught a 340-foot line drive. This celebration turned out to be just a little premature, and Tony La Russa was left to politely question the umpire's judgment.
The call was wrong. The catch deserves not to be out there because he's the closest one to it, right down the line. I can't believe it. I can't believe it. Attaboy, Tony, all right.
Although Tony couldn't quite see it their way, the umpire's decision stood, and the home run became a double. Third base was put back on, and the Orioles went on to win that game 2-1. But the White Sox, who were now headed east on an important road trip, did not let the tainted loss get them down. They responded by taking 3 straight from the Yankees in Yankee Stadium, aided by this game-winning RBI double from Mike Squires in the 13th inning. Squires, who is better known for his glove than his bat, showed that he could play ugly as well. But back home, the Bull still had to add the last jewel to his downtown triple crown.
Before.
While Luzinski was driving him wild, the Sox were catching fire. And on September the 11th, young, reliable Harold Baines got his second consecutive game-winning RBI to widen the gap to 16 and a half. Now it was just a matter of time. September 17th, the day Chicago fans had waited for 24 years. Harold Baines, on his way to a major league record 22 game-winning RBIs, came through again, scoring the Juice Julio Cruz with a title winner. The White Sox faithful had forgotten the frustration that now seemed so very, very far away, and for their heroes, this was a moment that comes but once in a lifetime.
Just once in a lifetime, a man knows a moment, one wonderful moment, when fate takes his hand, and this is my moment, my once in a lifetime, when I can explore a new and exciting land. Once in my lifetime, I feel like a giant. I soar like an eagle, as though I had wings. For this is my moment, my destiny calls me. And though it may be just once in my lifetime, I'm gonna do great things. My once in a lifetime, when I can explore a new and exciting land. Once in my lifetime, I feel like a giant. I soar like an eagle, as though I had wings. For this is my moment, my destiny calls me. And though it may be just once in a lifetime,
although the Sox clinched their divisional flag with over 2 weeks left to play, the winning continued till the end, and they won a major league high 99 games. They proved to their loyal fans at Comiskey Park that winning ugly could be beautiful. The 2,132,000 fans, who themselves broke all attendance records for any team in the history of Chicago sports, proved their appreciation of the White Sox excellence on the field. They gave their team a tremendous send-off as the Sox prepared for the Baltimore Orioles, and for the first time in almost a quarter of a century, the pressures of October.
You have to learn to pace yourself. Pressure. You're just like everybody else. Pressure. You've only had to run so far, so good. But you will come to a place where the only thing you feel are loaded guns in your face, and you'll have to deal with pressure. Don't ask for help, you're all alone.
Pressure.
You'll have to answer to your own.
Pressure.
I'm sure you'll have some cosmic rationale. But here you are in the ninth, two men out and three men on the way to look, but inside where we all respond to pressure.
The Orioles were able to earn the American League title only by beating Britt Burns, who pitched a brilliant five-hit shutout for nine innings before falling in the final championship game. Although Burns came out on the losing side that day, he won everybody's heart as he pitched one of the best games of his career. Barely missing a trip to the World Series, the Sox virtually swept the league's postseason awards. Ron Kittle's 35 home runs and 100 RBIs made him a natural for the American League's Rookie of the Year award. Lamar Hoyt, the winningest pitcher in the major leagues over the last 2 years, finally received his due, the American League Cy Young Award for this 24-game winner. Greg Luzinski, who pounded out 32 home runs, a new record for designated hitters. He was named the year's outstanding DH for the second time in the last 3 years. Skipper Tony La Russa, who showed his toughness leading his club to the divisional title, was a natural to win the league's Manager of the Year award. And finally, this man, whose astute judgment made it all possible, the White Sox general manager, Roland Heeman, chosen American League Executive of the Year. But now the successful 1983 season is a part of baseball history. It's time to look ahead to 1984, and the Sox do it all over again. And you can come back out to Comiskey Park and enjoy that great White Sox feeling. What a feeling. Feels believing. I can't have it all. Now I'm dancing for the night. Take your passion and make it happen. Pictures come online. Now I'm dancing through my life. What a feeling. What a feeling.
I am moving now.
Feels
believing.
I am rhythm now.
Pictures come alive. You can dance right through your life. What a feeling.
The story of the 1983 Chicago White Sox was brought to you by Budweiser, the king of beers and proud sponsor of the U.S. Olympic team. For all you do, this Bud's for you.